have a big red fireball in my mouth with big red teeth, so just overlook it. It's just the way it goes. I know I'm not the only one here that's had a rough year, but this has just been a rough year for me. I'm not going to start crying, but and you all know you've been through that. I lost two of the most special people in the world to me, and I'm just lost sometimes trying to find my way because I counted on them. They both had dementia, but I counted on them as much as they counted on me. And then my husband fell and hurt his back, and he's going to have a major surgery next Wednesday. And it's just like, ugh. Then there's three or four or five other things going right along with that. We'll go to the woods. But anyway, but through all that, I've learned really just to slow down and just to love people and just to enjoy people around me. And that stuff that doesn't matter when you get angry with people, it just doesn't matter. Just forgive and go on and love them because they're not here forever. And it's such a joy and honor just to have friends. And that's living and that's life. And I guess that's all I have to say tonight. And I'll open up with prayer and you all can crank it out. Lord, we just thank you for this day and we thank you for the gift of friendship. Lord, just give us the hearts to forgive and just to love and just to keep going on and just to share your joy. Because it's your joy that comes through us. And thank you. Thank you for family. And thank you for loving us. We just lift you up. Amen.
it's long for to be overcome by your presence, that in my sin
You know, what's interesting to me is I think the Lord did that for us. I think it's because of his grace and his mercy that he allowed us to have the last few years with him in the way that he was. Because years ago, I know you've heard me talk about him, but he wasn't a very nice person. And you know, when I got to thinking about how the Lord did that for us, because, you know, that transition would have been so much harder had we had all that, all those unresolved issues and those feelings and all those things that we would have had to deal with the rest of our lives. And the Lord just removed that. He took all of that guilt and that hurt and that anger and the bitterness. He took all of that away when we were able to have a relationship with him. And he began to soften. And as I walked around this week and I thought, oh, poor pitiful me and how awful it's been. But then for the grace of God. The grace of God that stood by me, Lucia, when I just didn't see any goodness anymore. But the grace of God was still good to me. And I'm thankful for that tonight.
Amen. You know, that is how the grace of God works. That's how he is. And sometimes his hand is even in things that we don't even understand at the time. But he takes all things. And he works them out for our good. All things. As you all were singing tonight, the very first song, Holy Spirit, you are welcome here. There's one line in that song that says, let us become more aware of your presence. You know, there's absolutely nothing like the presence of God. But the presence of God is not something that we have to work up. We have to try to get to. It's just something that we have to be aware of. The presence of God is in us, around us, through us, surrounding us, every moment of every day. The scripture also teaches us that times of refreshing come from the presence of the Lord. And you know, I've heard Cynthia and I've heard Alicia tonight talking about the hard times. But see, I know that just about everybody in here and those watching have had hard times this year. It's been rough. There have been rough patches that have happened in our lives. But according to Scripture and according to my experience, and I know your experience, times of refreshing come from the presence of the Lord. The thing is, we just have to be aware of that presence that is already there. So why aren't we? Well, when times are rough, we tend to be thinking about the rough stuff. When times are busy, we're just trying to get things done. There's so many distractions in life that just keep us from realizing who we've got in us and who we've got around us at every moment of every day. When I left out of here on Sunday, I thought, The worship in here was so wonderful. The week before I left, and I thought the worship in here was so wonderful, and I felt the presence of God. And as I was leaving this past Sunday, it just hit me. Yes, the worship was wonderful, and the presence of God was there, and the scripture teaches us that He comes that way. But that very same presence is there all the time. See, the thing is, in worship, our attention is just there. It's just where we put our focus. It's where we put our attention. And what we give our attention to manifest. When we give our attention to our Heavenly Father, to what our Lord and Savior Jesus Christ has done, to the very presence of the Holy Spirit here with us, it manifests. And you know what? When we give our attention to the wrong things, that manifests too. It just does. Where we give our attention is what happens in our life. And that's why it's so important to do what the scripture says, to cast down every thought and imagination that exalts itself against the knowledge of God. See, I want us to have a time of refreshing in here tonight. And if you would, everybody, if you want to stand, stand. If you want to sit, sit. But we're going to take just a moment, and we're going to focus our attention on our Lord and Savior, Jesus Christ. We're going to focus our attention on the presence of God here with us, and just allow that very presence to minister to us, to refresh us as we minister to Him. And you might say, well, I don't know what to say to Him. You don't have to say anything. You can just tell Him that you love Him. You can just be in His presence. You can say it out loud. You can say it in your mind. He is an all-knowing God. And He will fellowship with you right where you are. Cynthia, thank you for playing. Everybody in here, just close your eyes. Lord, we lift our attention to You tonight. And we thank You so much for Your very presence. I ask You, Holy Spirit, just to sit in this house, to move from breast to breast, from person to person, and let Your presence become real. We just thank You. Oh, how we love You. How we worship You. Lord, we just take a minute to adore You tonight. You are everything. Thank You. Thank You. Help us all to be more aware. presence envelop each and every one as they sleep. To tangibly feel you, Lord, your presence there. Thank you, Lord God. Thank you. Thank you. We thank you for this time tonight. We thank you that you meet us where we are. We thank you that your presence is here and that you're real. We thank you for your love and for your goodness. We thank you for life and breath and health and strength. But most of all, Lord, we thank you for your love, your mercy, and your grace. And your goodness that you extend to our lives every day, even when we don't realize it. We come into this place tonight to honor you and to worship you and to fellowship with your children. Holy Spirit, we just ask you, have your way through this congregation. Have your way in the ministry tonight. Have your way as we fellowship afterwards, as we go back to our homes. Just have your way in our lives. And we give you honor and glory and praise tonight. In Jesus' name, amen. Sometimes it's hard just to get your mind to be still, isn't it? But when you do, isn't it worth it? He just meets us in that place and in that way. We're so glad to have each and every one of you out here tonight. It is a good day. It is a good night. If you weren't here on Sunday, we had a special announcement on Sunday. Do we have the quilt here? Oh, right here in front of me. If you and Brian can come hold that up again tonight. For those that weren't here, Miss Jean Hayden and Miss Pat Potter, they put their resources together and bought the materials for this quilt, and Miss Jean made the quilt. So it's handmade. It's a queen size quilt, and they donated this quilt to the church. They put their time, their effort, their energy, their love into it, and so that we could take this and raffle it off and raise money to finish out the kitchen in the church. It was a wonderful, wonderful gift. And didn't they do a great job? Give them a big hand for that. But the tickets for this are two tickets for $5 or five tickets for $10. And we'll be selling tickets for this until August the 30th. And on August the 30th, we'll draw the winner of the quilt here at church on Sunday morning. So if you would like to participate in helping to sell that, that would be absolutely wonderful. The ladies told me Sunday that their goal is for us to sell 1,000 tickets. Now, 1,000 tickets would do wonders for our kitchen. So we would love anyone who wants to help us with that effort to help out. And we just thank you so much. We've already had quite a few being sold and quite a bit of money coming in, but we have from now to August the 30th. And so I believe that through their gift, through their love, through their resources, God will do great things. Amen. Also, yes? It's right before the first Tennessee game. That's right. So you can have a brand new quilt on your bed for the first Tennessee game. One other announcement. We had a call from Crossville today. We typically go to Crossville on the first Saturday of every month, but they had someone requesting a schedule change, and so they want us to come this Friday instead of next Saturday. So we'll be going this Friday evening. We'll leave the church by about 6. If you would like to go, let us know if you can. I know Fridays are harder than Saturdays because people have to work, but if anyone would like to go, please let Pastor I know as soon as possible so we can make arrangements to meet up with everybody and do what we need to do. Any other announcements? All right, then. Young people, we'll go on back tonight. And Pastor, go right ahead.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, I know Fridays are hard for everybody. And if you can go, we would appreciate it. If you can't go, we understand it completely. Crossville is a different place, and it's always a good place to go and minister to those precious people. Good to see everybody. Everybody looks happy. A little bit tired, but everybody looks happy. And as Alicia and Cynthia was saying earlier, it has been a hard year, a tough year for everybody. But I believe we're breaking out of it. And I believe it's going to be a better. The first 6 months was rough. Next 6 months, I believe, is going to be a lot better. Yes. So that's just what I believe in the name of the Lord. Everybody say the Lord is good.
The Lord is good.
Good to have Sharon and the boys and Hector. Yes. He's back. And all the boys. Adrian, he's worked two shifts, and he's tired. He's, I think, asleep right there. I don't even know I'm talking about him right now at this particular time. But anyway, but just checking you there, brother. Make sure he's with us. But we just pray that he gets to feeling better. Yeah, I know. You've been working two shifts. So anyway, put my title up there, Mr. Grady, if you will. Won't be too long tonight, whatever that means. But remember Dennis. Dennis is having a really serious surgery next Thursday and Wednesday. I don't know why I said Thursday. He's got some major back issues. He's been in a lot of pain for how long? Since the end of February. He fell and hurt his back, and he's been in excruciating pain, and now they've got it set to where they're going to be able to fix him. And I thank the Lord for doctors. And doctors and God's in the same business. That's the healing business. So we just thank the Lord for that. So remember, Dennis, do you know what time the surgery is going to be yet? 1 o'clock. So 1 o'clock Wednesday, Dennis is going to get some work done on him. Everybody say the design. If you was here Sunday, you probably got a little bit of a grasp of what we're talking about. Everybody say change.
Change.
I know we talk about change all the time, but when change comes, we don't like it at all. None of us like change. David Huskin said one time, the only thing that's going to remain the same is change, and I do believe that. Put up my first scripture right there just for a second, and we'll get started right here. I don't even really know how to start what I want to say tonight, other than me and you are in some of the most awesome times, or perfect place, I guess is what I want to say, that we could be in. Even in the midst of all that's going on, we are in a perfect place and a perfect position for the Lord to do what he needs to do. And you know what? This is the truth. I'm glad I am. I'm glad I'm who I am. Okay, let me say that again. I'm glad I am who I am. I wouldn't want to be nobody else. And you don't need to be wanting to be anybody else. Just be you. You know, when I was in school, I didn't do good in school. Sharon can tell you I didn't do good in school. All of those five of us kids, all of them went to college except me. I didn't go to college. Do you remember when you was in school, when I don't know about you, but they would give you these little sheets to color, you know, like a coloring book page, and they would tell you to stay in the lines. I never colored in the lines. Paul would color perfectly in the lines. Everybody else in my family would color perfectly in the lines. And my school teacher would get all over me. She'd say, I think she cussed me once. Can't you color within the lines? I don't know why I could not color within the lines. But you know what? I would take that ugly picture home and show it to Mama, and she would say, oh, how pretty. And I thought, you know, that's this one cussed me out because I wasn't coloring the lines. But my mama, I took it to her, and she thought it was the most wonderful thing in the world. My teachers felt the same way about me personally. They thought I was a mess. They thought I was crazy. But my mama thought I was the best thing that ever hit the planet. She did. And you know what most of us do in most of our lives? We are people. Let me say it this way. Religion teaches us to live our lives within the lines. Be good, talk right, spit white, conservative, vote Republican, go to church, tithe, don't cuss, don't drink. And I don't know what you feel about all that, but what they're saying is stay within the lines. Don't get outside the lines. And see, I tried to live my life that way for 50-some years, and when I got around other people that didn't live within the lines, it bothered me. Now, I ain't saying I'm a hard, cold, hard sinner now because I'm outside the lines. That ain't what I'm saying. But you know what I found out? I went back to thinking about, you know, it was fun just coloring like that. But it was aggravating to try to stay within the lines. Some people would take all day coloring a Santa Claus picture. I could color Santa Claus in 5 seconds. He's colored. Teacher didn't like it. Take it home to Mama, and she thought it was wonderful, and she would put it on the refrigerator. Religion has taught us to stay within the lines. And when you stay in the lines, you got the approval of God. You know what I found out? God don't really care whether you stay in the lines or not. Oh, I thank you for your excitement right there. It don't really bother God will you get out of the lines or not. And I'll show you that in just a few minutes. The design. Let me get back to the design. In the Old Testament, God was getting ready to build a tabernacle. And here's what he says next to 25 verse number 8. Getting ready to build this wonderful tabernacle. And he says, let them make me a tabernacle that I may dwell among them. Now, the interesting part about this was God wants to dwell among people. That's what God wants to do. And he gave Moses this plan. This plan was, it was an incredible plan. 50 cubits this way, 50 cubits that way, 100 cubits this way, 10 cubits high, all these different cubits, all these different measurements. And listen to this. This tabernacle had to be built perfect. It could not be off one iota. Not one iota could this tabernacle be off. And when Moses built this tabernacle and got it complete and it was perfect and it was perfected, in Exodus chapter number 40, God came and dwelled in that tabernacle because it was perfect. Now, if it had been imperfect, God would not have ever came and lived in that tabernacle. That was Old Testament. Give me my next set of scriptures. When Jesus gets ready to build in Matthew chapter 16, this is what I find interesting. And when Jesus came into the coast of Caesarea Philippi, he asked his disciples, saying, whom do men say that I am, the Son of Man am? And they said, some say thou art John the Baptist, some Elias, and others Jeremiah, so one of the prophets. And he saith unto them, but who say ye that I am? And Simon Peter answered and said, thou art the Christ, the Son of the living God. Now watch this. Watch Jesus now. Next verse. And Jesus answered and said unto him, blessed art thou, Simon Bar-Jonah, for flesh and blood hath not revealed it unto thee, but my Father which is in heaven. Watch this now. Watch this. And I say also unto thee that thou art Peter. Watch this now. And upon this rock I will. In the Old Testament, God's building a tabernacle that had to be perfect. In the New Testament, Jesus said, I will build my church, and the gates of hell shall not prevail against it. Now, watch what Jesus did. In the Old Testament, God's tabernacle had to be perfect. In the New Testament, now I know what Jesus is talking about here. He's saying, upon this rock, after Peter had the revelation of thieves of Christ, upon this rock I will build my church. We've always believed that what he's saying there is, I'm going to build my church upon the revelation of who I am, and that's true. But you've got to look at who he started with. He started with 12 guys that colored outside the lines. These weren't the priests. Am I boring y'all?
No.
These weren't the priests from downtown Jerusalem. These were radicals, cussers, tax collectors. They were people that lived their lives outside the line. The point I want to make is this. Old Testament says you've got to live it perfect. New Testament, here's what Jesus says. I build my church, watch this, through imperfect people. All our life, about every one of us went to church believing that we had to live the perfect life. Do it right, don't do it wrong. And the more you try to do it right, the more you got it wrong. And what he did with these 12 guys, one of them ended up committing suicide. You know what he did end up doing with them? He evangelized the whole continent of Asia in 30 years. We've got radio, we've got TV, we've got Revelation, we've got books, we've got Bibles, we've got tapes, we've got everything. And we can't get Anderson County stirred up. Do what? That's exactly right. Don't have love. These guys turned the world upside down. I think the Lord enjoys people that's not afraid to get outside the lines. Now, I'm not telling you to go down here and rob the convenient or anything like that. I ain't saying nothing. You understand what I'm saying? But people that live on the edge, or people that not afraid to take a risk, people that's not afraid to be a little bit different. We have so confined ourselves and colored within the lines that we are some of the most boring people on the planet. Thank you for your excitement right there. We're just boring. Okay, man. Remember Sunday when I said change something? Anybody change anything Sunday? Nobody changed nothing. Somebody changed their drawers? Hope so. Yeah. Yeah. That's right, Chris. And we care about you. And we love you. Now, just a few more things I want to say right here. Santa Claus covered within the lines may be pretty to you, but you know, he wasn't interested in me that way. I'd add some stuff to him. Some stuff, maybe I shouldn't have added. Yes, do have your way. Teacher did not appreciate that, but my comrades did. And Mama would just say, I don't know if you already drawed that part or not. But anyway, I've always felt like I was a little bit different. And when I got in trouble is when I tried to live within the confines of boundaries that God never put there for me. Now, I'm not saying I'm wild and crazy, but you know what? I feel free. Man, let me say it this way. If being bound gets you to heaven, like I was bound, not by drugs and alcohol, but being bound by religion, if being bound by religion gets you to heaven, you know what? I don't know where I want to go. Because you know what? I'd be hanging out with a bunch of bound people. And I don't want to be bound. Let me say it this way. I don't want to be bound with a bunch of bound people. There's another word I'd like to use, but I can't. I'll say Norse down. I don't want to be Norse down with a bunch of bound people. Yeah. Thank you. Now here, this is, listen to this thought right here. I'm about to quit right here. It's been 5 or 6 years ago. What year did you graduate? 2010, so it's 5 years ago. I think it was Justine's 2010 year that she was running track. We was at a track meet. I think it was MTSU down there. Some kind of regional meet or something. We was down there. It's amazing how God brings this stuff back to you. And I remember they was getting ready to run the 3,200. Now, Justine never did run the 3,200. That's 8 times around a lap. That's 2 miles. And they was getting ready to congregate to run that lap. And I remember seeing this girl down there, and her feet were turned inward. And one of her hands was sort of like this. And I thought, you know, she must be, and she had a track uniform on. I thought she must be a team manager or something, because she surely, to goodness, is not going to try to run 2 miles. She can't do that. And my thing was, she can't do that. Well, buddy, when they got ready to start, this girl got up on the line, and they shot the gun, and she ain't no team manager. She's running. And these other girls, they just run off and leave her. And when they're all finished, she's got about another lap or two to do. And she's out there on the track by herself. And I'm thinking, oh, my gosh, I feel so bad for this little girl. And she's running so awkwardly. And this is some kind of regional meet, and the whole stands is full. And I'm feeling bad for her. But when she came around toward that grandstand, the finish line, that last time, you know how big that place is down there? It was full of people. The thing, everybody stood up and they're going, go, 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 go. And they don't care what team she's for. They're just rooting this girl, go, go, go. And you know what? Here's what happened to me. I cannot tell you who won that race that night. I cannot tell you who come in first, but I sure can tell you who come in last. And the scripture came to me, Leisha, this scripture, the first shall be last, and the last shall be first. We've been so concerned with coloring in the lines, being first, being the biggest, being the best, had the best message, had the best church, that, hey, it don't make no difference to the great cloud of witnesses. That one that's lagging behind, that's barely making it, they're the one that stand up, holler, go, go, go. See, I would have told that little girl, you don't need to be running this. And I would try to put her within the confines of color within the lines. I don't know who won first. Could care less who won first. But I sure didn't know who come in last. I will never forget that. You know, that's why, Sharon, I appreciate you. You know, and I don't even know how, I want to be careful how I say this. Sometimes we think we got to have this certain kind of people. I don't know that that's, let me say it this way. I have that certain kind of people. Do you love me, Chris? Do you love me, Jeffrey? Do you hear what he said? Coloring outside the lines. So you see, most religious people will not accept you for who you are. See, that's the reason I'm so sorry. I had a hard time with her. But then I would walk away thinking, I wished I could be that way. Ain't that the way you feel? Yeah. You love me too? Yeah. Yeah, but that's okay. We're not making fun of you. We're going to love on you. Yeah. You know what? They may have thought you have a disability. We think you're the most awesome guy walk through that door there. You, Adrian, Chris, huh? You had a $100 bill in your pocket a while ago. Well, we're going to take up an offering. Bring the offering plate up here, boys. Here, you want to take a chance? I see that's, can I use you? That's been somewhat of your problem. You, at camera, does your family watch these broadcasts? Okay, yeah, probably. You know, you had your sister, your brother, your mama, and then there was Leisha, who colors outside the lines. I mean, if you've seen her sister and then seen her and was around them for a little while, you'd think Leisha's not related to her, or she's not related to Leisha. I'm not embarrassing Emma. Leisha is outside the lines. I almost said her name. Her sister's inside the lines. Her mama is way inside the line. Watch what Jesus is like. My mama hanging on a cross, stretched out like this. There was a thief hanging there. And he just looked at him and said, you know what, man? I've lived my life outside the lines all my life. I've lived outside the lines all my life. That's what he's saying. And he just looked at Jesus and he said, can you receive this picture that's lived outside its lines? And you know what Jesus said? Yeah, today I'll hang you up in paradise. And see, the thing of it is, the more you try to color inside the lines, the more miserable you will be. Now, I'm not telling you to go down here and rob the crystal pistol. I ain't telling you to do that. I'm telling you just be you. That's it. Just be an abstract. But every time we get lost, he finds us. Did you hear what Cynthia said? And Chris said? What if there is no lines? Lines are boundaries. And you just color. You just color. We got... And lines are boundaries. And you know, sometimes it's harder to love the people inside the lines than it is the ones on the outside the lines. Oh, Jesus. I don't know if I made any sense or not tonight. Sometimes I feel like we're that sort of that group of people that's sort of lagging up behind, but the whole grandstand's standing up saying, go, 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 go. You know, a lot of people are looking to finish first. I have no interest in being first. What I do have an interest in is just living free and enjoying every single day for what it is. Yeah. So let's just do away with the lines. There you go. Anybody else got a comment? Yeah. You know, with God, there is no disabilities. Amen. Anybody else got anything? Hope, you got anything? You got anything? You got anything? Huh? Is this all right? Jesus took 12 dudes. They didn't have no wines. Turn the world upside down. Everybody kept trying to put them. You ever heard this saying? You need to get in line. Heard it all my life. But anyway, God is good. All right, who wants to pray for us tonight as we close? Our hearts and minds to you. Let me nominate somebody. I could tell Bill was ready to pray.
Last week, Shane Yoga, suit the me too, because that's my born and raised in Chattanooga. And I just want to pray for me too, thanks.
Yeah.
And that's what we need.
Yeah.
God be with them all their lives. And I'll be with. May the God be with you in spirit and love and cherish. And so in Jesus our name, amen.
Amen. Good prayer. Jonathan, next Wednesday night, you're praying. There you go. All right. Have a good night, everybody. Yeah, he did.